For a period of almost 20 years, the French Jesuit priest and lawyer, Claude Francois Fraguiet, 1666 to 1728, persisted in prosecuting a case at law that his friends persisted in telling him he could not possibly win. Finally, the case was decided against him. His friends all reminded Francois that Claude Francois, that had he never gotten involved in the case, he would not have lost and he would have spared himself much sorrow and heartbreak. Fraguiet replied, "Every night before I go to sleep, I've managed to win this case. You call that nothing? Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Therefore, let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us." How we run the race, and what the race is, and what it looks like, is a matter of discussion, dialogue, and debate. What does it mean to run the race for which Jesus is the pioneer and the perfecter? I don't know whether the fact that the Presbyterian Church USA was in the news, in the New York Times, and major headlines, although not nearly as major as it would have been 30 years ago, whether that fact has drawn some of you here this morning, whether you want to hear a word from the pulpit about this, or whether you're hoping the preacher will shut up and not talk about it. But I suspect some of you are here because you want to hear about it. There were two, at least two, but there were two issues that made the news nationally and internationally. One was the decision of the General Assembly to divest stock, $21 million of stock currently invested in three companies that help Israel with its occupation and settlement of the West Bank. Caterpillar, which has bulldozed Palestinian homes, and Hewlett-Packard and Motorola, which are involved in security operations in which there's constant communication between Israeli authorities and the army and Israelis who are living in these settlements. Now, the vote was very close. It was 310 to 303. Not an overwhelming mandate. But we are a church, the Presbyterian Church USA, that makes decisions by majority rule. We are a representative, democratic, constitutional church. Well, the concern here, as I indicated last Sunday, the concern of the church is twofold. Number one, how do we support the people of Palestine who live under Israeli occupation? And number two, from my point of view, how do we not allow our opposition to continued occupation of Palestine by Israel to become the new expression of the long-standing, two-millennia-old anti-Jewish, anti-Semitism that runs in the blood of Christians. There are a few Jewish leaders who welcome this action. Most of them do not. They remember what Presbyterians did and what Lutherans did in this country and in Germany and all around the world of not enfranchising Jewish citizens, of demeaning them, of belittling them. They were the Christ killers. And that view still flows through our blood. So this is tough. This was a difficult decision. And I guarantee you that the relationship downtown Minneapolis between Westminster Church, which advocates for this divestment, and Temple Israel is not better because of this. They are neighbors. When I was there, we had wonderful relationships, the rabbi and all of the other Christian clergy in downtown Minneapolis. And Tim Hart Anderson at Westminster has continued that. But it's not simple, is it? The other question with respect to this is, when ruling elders and teaching elders in the Presbyterian Church take our vows of ordination, we vow, we promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church. Well, that's not easy. It's tough. And as I look at what has been happening with the loss, the decision of over 400 congregations to leave the Presbyterian Church USA because they think on behalf of purity, as they understand it, they want a pure church. And they think we've wandered off the path, that we have stopped running the race in the way that Jesus would have us run it and in the way that Scripture would have us run it. But there's another kind of purity, which goes on the other side of the aisle, and it's the purity, it's the sin of purity of which I've often been guilty, which is the sin of right all the time. There is no purity. There is no way for you to be pure. There's no way for me to be pure. Maybe if I was Amish. Maybe. We all have dirty hands. And so is the job of the race to which we are called to come out with clean hands? Well, what would clean hands look like? On the one side, it means what the churches who are leaving say it is. On the other side, on my side, it means taking a stand, prosecuting or defending in the courts of law for what is right and good, whether or not it maintains the peace and unity of the church. It's a dilemma. So the other issue that came before the assembly had to do with gay marriage. And those of you who have been members of the Presbyterian Church for many years remember that we've been discussing Well, we haven't been discussing gay marriage, but we've been discussing issues of sexuality and same gender relationships since 1977. That's a long time to talk. It's a long time to think, a long time to fight, a long time to decide whose flag is going to be hoisted up the denominational flagpole. Well, so this assembly decided by a vote of 3-1 to recommend to the presbyteries that the language in the Book of Order defining marriage be changed so that the gender is not the defining characteristic of whether or not two people are married. Now that has to be changed. That's a constitutional amendment to the Book of Order that has to be ratified by a majority of presbyteries. As I said, we are a representative democracy in the Presbyterian Church. And so we don't have a bishop or a conference of bishops to say, this is the way it's going to be. We all discuss it, participate in it. If a majority of presbyteries approve it, it will become the law of the Presbyterian Church. In the meantime, they also took a position that does not need a constitutional amendment, which gives to pastors and sessions and presbyteries the right to use pastoral discretion in whom they marry in states like Minnesota, where gay marriage is legal. So these two issues, and I'm sure others, will lead to much discussion over the year to come and over the months to come. Some of what has been written about and spoken in commentaries about these two actions says that the die is cast for the Presbyterian Church USA to shrink even further. I think that's true. So I have to say, sometimes I don't know what to do. I don't know what the right thing is to do. I don't think anybody knows the right thing to do. In 1991, in Baltimore, Maryland, I chaired the Committee on Human Sexuality, which received a report on human sexuality, not homosexuality, but human sexuality, that had been prepared over 3 years by a special committee. But before the lead up to the General Assembly, the layman, a conservative journal, I call it the Yellow Journal, but anyway, the conservative journal that comments on what's happening on the Presbyterian Church attacked that report before they had even read it. And by the time we got to General Assembly in Baltimore, there was a stack of 10,000 letters to the moderator of the General Assembly opposing the report that they had not read. Isn't that interesting? So I got stuck with the job of moderating the committee of 67 people. That's bigger than the attendance here this morning. So we're all going to convene this morning as a committee. Isn't that wonderful? We'll have a great committee discussion, won't we? 67 people, very contentious. What to do? Strong opinions from one side, strong opinions from the other. accept this report or deny this report. And so it was clear to the committee as we discussed this, it became clearer and clearer that this study, actually is what it was to be, this report, this study, which was supposed to be referred to congregations like this for study over a period of time, could not be the church-wide study. You don't study something you're opposed to before you study it. It could not be the mechanism or the vehicle by which people would think theologically and ethically about these issues. And so the recommendation to the assembly, which was unanimous by the committee of 67 and was adopted by 94% of the commissioners, was that the report and the study be placed in the literature of the General Assembly so that those who wish it could draw on it, but that it not become the document by which the whole church would study the issue. I had strong feelings about that. But the unity of the church was at stake at that point. Whether or not we would continue a food fight was at stake at that point. But the residual consequences of the decision to be the peacemaker ate away at my soul over the years that followed, because I never spoke my heart except to be a peacemaker. I put the peace and unity of the church ahead of what I thought was right and good. And when I came back to Knox Church in Cincinnati, the gay members of that church were sorely disappointed. And it took a lot of work to repair that damage. How do we live in the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen yet? How do we run with perseverance the race that is set before us? Well, the letter to the Hebrews says that God took an oath with God's own self. God had a conversation with himself, pardon the gender-specific language, the way we sometimes have a little meeting with ourselves. And then, to give assurance to Abram, God communicated it and called him Abraham for Abraham's assurance, so that Abraham would know it, so that Abraham could depend upon the covenant promise when it got rough. God's oath to Abraham, God's oath to God's own self, became the public promise on which Abraham would fix his faith as the assurance of things hoped for and not yet seen. Then, in the fullness of time, according to our Christian story, God ratified that promise in the sending of the Son, Jesus Christ. We have this hope, a sure anchor of the soul. It is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen, that led Fraguiet to pursue his case and to respond to those who thought he was foolish. Every night before I fall asleep, I have managed to win this case. You call that nothing? He believed that in the end, truth and right would prevail. And so for him as for us, life has a way of knocking us down. We see the worst in humankind, and if we're honest, sometimes with great horror, we see it also in ourselves, which is precisely why the Hebrews writer talks about the sin that clings so closely and which weighs us down and holds us back. Sometimes thick clouds are much more evident than the sun, the night and darkness more real than the day and the light, the leaves and the blossoms fall as well as bud, a loved one dies, or we get sick, or we suffer, and the death or the suffering raises the question of life's meaning or purpose. The church is divided, and we feel the hurt and the pain of winning and losing, and who is on the Lord's side. And what we thought to be a fountain of living water turns out to be a mirage. Life has a way of knocking us down, or stalling us, of ending the race of faith we once began, which is why Lord Tennyson wrote in the ancient sage Song of Faith, "She sees the best that glimmers through the worst. She feels the sun is hid, but for a night. She spies the summer through the winter bud. She tastes the fruit before the blossom falls. She hears the lark within the songless egg. She finds the fountain where they wailed mirage." Life will knock you down. Life will knock us down as a church. But those for whom hope has become an anchor of the soul, the conviction of things not seen, the best will glimmer through the worst, the night will not do in the sun, the winter bud will be the foretaste of summer, the sweet taste of fruit before the blossom falls will be a foretaste of the fruit still yet to come, the fruit of the kingdom of God in its glory. The songless egg will be the temporary protective shell, one day to be broken open by the lovely song of the meadowlark and the cry, "Mirage, it's all an illusion," will not destroy our ability to drink from the fountain of God's eternal transforming grace. Grace and the gospel are an end and also a beginning. The gospel is the beginning of something to fall asleep on every night. The promise of God and our oath in return, the promise that God's case will be won in the end, not by us, but by God's inscrutable working in time, in God's good time, and in God's often inscrutable way in history. It remains for us only to run with race, with the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Therefore, church, Christian, wherever you are and whoever you are, consider him who endured such hostility against himself for sinners, so that you may not grow weary or lose heart. Keep running the race justly, kindly, humbly, which is the only way that the disciples of Jesus and the children of Abraham and Sarah can run it. Amen.